Wrokdown, Wrokdown, down memory lane. Wrokdown, Wrokdown, see those guys again.
Wrokdown.
And
ta-da.
Darryl Cotton.
Hi, Wendy.
How are you, darling?
Good to see you.
I didn't even see Rick Springfield in that band.
No.
I used to just push my way up the front and get any girl out of the way that was in front of you.
To see me? Gosh, what do I do? I'm embarrassed. A lot of girls like Rick Springfield, though, because it was dark and moody and
Didn't do it for me, so.
No, well, that's very nice of you to say.
Hey, this is Soozie, out and about for Wrokdown TV with Miss Chrissie. And we've wandered down to the Palais, the concert for Daz, and it's to celebrate the life of the wonderful Darryl Cotton. So we've got some great people here and some funny buggers to tell some yarns about Darryl. Wen, we've got Miss Wendy.
How are you?
I'm really excited.
You're looking gorgeous.
You are gorgeous always. And we're here together.
We're here backstage at the Palais.
At the Palais.
For Darryl's concert.
Yeah.
And we've just been on. And it was fun. We were on, we were off.
And but you sung up a storm.
Oh, well, we did whatever we did. It was all good. It was all good. And, you know, you could just feel the audience are with you.
Yeah.
Everyone is, everyone's really with us tonight.
Yeah. Darryl is too.
Oh, God, I hope he didn't see what I just did.
Of course he did.
He'd be going crook at me.
What'd you do?
He'd be going crook at me. Darryl was fantastic because, in actual fact, he looked after everyone. He literally was the dad to everybody in all the bands, not just Darryl's band, Cotton band, but even with Jimmy Keys and Russell Morris. Darryl looked after everything, and we're all floundering a bit at the moment, and yeah, we miss him very much. But yeah, as you said, he's here, he's watching.
And now with Cotton Keys, well, you said Keys. What did you say? Keys, Morris.
It was only so that I could say and.
And me, yeah.
And yourself.
The Three Stooges, Curly, Larry, and Mo, we're affectionately known as.
The busiest Three Stooges.
It's been incredible. Yeah, yeah. Russell and I got together 14 years ago.
We're not crying. We're crying with laughter. We've been talking about a few things that Darryl did in the past, which we can't repeat.
Which we'd love to.
But they were very, very funny, yeah.
One little muck up that you can.
Well, he was a wonderful guy. Actually, he had a Mother Teresa gene in his body. He couldn't help helping people.
Yeah.
It was shocking. One story which goes back to that, which was fantastic. He came home one night and Darryl didn't drink a lot. And he happened to go to Barney's Beanery, which was a cowboy bar with sawdust on the floor, and they played cowboy music. It was on Melrose Drive in Los Angeles. And he came home and he said, I saw this guy passed out on the floor. And he said, I really got worried. He said, I thought he'd had a heart attack. So I went over to help him. And when I got closer, he had all sawdust in his hair and sawdust on his clothes. He had a check shirt on. And he said, I realised he was drunk. He was pissed as a newt. And he said, I looked at him and he said, I had to look again. He said, what? And it was Neil Young.
Oh,
so for that reason, Jimmy and I always include a Neil Young song in our shows.
In the song?
Yeah.
It's hard to believe it's that long. And we did a little bit of a stint with Ronnie Burns.
That's right. It was
six years with him.
Four.
Oh, we were always mucking around because we were a couple of jesters, yeah. You know, and we should have been on a deck of cards. In fact, we probably are somewhere in the past. But, that's the memory for me is that we just had a lot of fun. And it's that enjoyment of life, that lust for life.
Yeah. What song do you think of when you think of him?
Will I, probably.
Will I?
Yeah, it's a sort of a statement about him because he's actually saying, will I make a man of my life and will I build a home and take a wife? And he taught me all the harmonies to that with Russell. And so those are big statements for me about who he was.
And then Ronnie went off and Jim Keyes got on board. And at first I was horrified because Jim Keyes, not him. I said, Russell, I don't want to work with him.
Really?
Well, in the old days, Zoot and Master's Apprentices were mortal enemies, really? You know. So
it was that serious?
Yeah, yeah. Well, no, not really, but we just didn't mix in the same circles.
But it was competitive.
Yeah, and I thought,
you know, very pretty boys.
As you know, Darryl did everything. He organised the airfares, the accommodation, the car hire. He did paid the guys, worked out who was with the PA and everything. He did everything, and so much so that we used to share a unit when we go interstate, and I'd hear it from the other room. I'd hear, Jimmy, do you want me to iron your shirt, mate? And I go, I don't iron my shirts, mate. And he goes, oh, but I'm doing mine, so I might as well do yours as well. And I go, all right, Darryl, here's my shirt.
Did he iron it any good?
Yeah, well, I don't know. He's good. He's quite a domestic boy. So he'd do everything, including iron my shirts.
Iron your
shirt. Unbelievable. Did and polish my shoes as well, because he was one for having shiny shoes. You have to have shiny shoes. And I never bothered with my shoes, you know. But he had to have his shoes so you could see your face in them, you know. So he'd shine my shoes as well and iron my shirts and do everything. He was fantastic like that.
Did he cook your brekkie?
Well, he would have if we were around. He did everything.
The other thing I was thinking of the other day was they were jumpsuits. A lot of them were like cat suits.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
What happened if you...
Oh, we had all those. In fact, in Brisbane one time, I had all my clothes.
Needed to go to use the bathroom.
Oh, no, we could do that. I mean, that, it was stretchy. It was that spandex stuff, you know, long before Rod Stewart had it. But we used to... At one time in Brisbane, I remember it actually... I had the whole thing ripped off and I was down to basically my undies and that was about it. And then the police, being Brisbane, rushed on stage at Festival Hall and took me off.
And arrested you?
Well, they said they were going to if I continued. And so I just put a pair of, I can't remember what I put on, I put a pair of shorts on or something and raced back out on stage. But it was all fun.
It was great fun.
Yeah, it was good fun.
So Mr. Cotton, he's been pretty popular. We've heard that he polishes shoes and irons shirts while on tour. And he plays cricket too.
Yeah, maybe it's associated with Darryl's.
The Darryl's.
I mean, I love ironing, so maybe that's us Darryl's, you know, maybe that's...
I could help you out there. I've got about three baskets at home.
Oh, have you?
You could do that.
But no, I mean, Darryl is, having worked with him, not that often over the years, but I mean, going back to the first time I ever saw him with Zoot.
Yeah.
And I think it was even before Sherbet started. So it would have been the 60s sometimes, and they were great, and he was great then. And
what do you reckon one word to describe tonight? Hard, isn't
one
it, in
word.
One word? My hard task.
Rewarding.
Rewarding. What a beautiful word. Yeah.
Well, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for your time.
Wrokdown.
Welcome back to Wrokdown. My special guest is Mr. Peter Pan himself.
Oh, get out.
Oh, you are, look.
Yeah, sure.
I have one thing I loved. We were on stage and Wendy was doing a song and told everyone to do like the hand jive and all different sorts of dances. And Darryl said that he got caught once doing the mashed potato in his room by his mum.
And he was 29 when he was doing it.
Hey, were you all Adelaide boys?
Beeb and I were. Oh, Rick Brewer was, of course, yeah. The three of us, Beeb, Rick Brewer and myself, we were all Adelaide boys.
So you grew up?
Beeb and I grew up together. We actually came to Melbourne in 68. It's 40 years this year we came to Melbourne.
Hey, were your family English?
No, just Aussies.
Because, you know, there's so many people
that
you talk to that came from that actual, like, almost immigrant enclave of, like, Elizabeth, you know, as you're saying, like, Doc Neeson's English, isn't it?
Oh, yeah, I mean, Jimmy Barnes, Glenn Shorrock, it goes on and
it
on.
It does, so, and Jimmy Keyes.
Jimmy was originally Scottish, but, yeah. And that was the same with me growing up. At school, all my mates were English.
Hey, Soozie here again, and I'm here with the fabulous Mr. Barry Smith. Hey, Barry.
Hey, Soozie.
Good to be here.
It's lovely to be here, yes. It's at the back of the concert. We've just done our bit and... It was great. It was so far so good.
So you've known Darryl for a while?
I have. We go back to probably, look, I won't mention the year, but it was the under 14 cricket side back in Marion High School in Adelaide. I happened to be captain of the side, and Darryl was in the team. And look, he'd be the first one to admit he wasn't the greatest cricketer, but he was, you know, but he was bubbly, he was cheeky, he was funny, and he was a very popular member of the side. I remember he used to nag me all the time about giving him a bowl. He'd start off with, "Hey, Baz, when are you going to give me a bowl?" To Smithy, "You're going to give me a bowl?" To Smithy, "You're going to give me a bloody bowl, you bastard?" So when he'd shut up, I'd chuck him the ball. Now, Cotto's been known to have lost games off his own bat, you know, to coin a phrase, but he used to bowl these lollipop balls that the opposition batsmen used to love to smash over the fence for six, you know, to the drudgery of the captain. Anyway, so this day, he would suggest it happened several times, but it only happened once, I'm positive about that. He actually got a guy trying to hit him over the fence, caught out on the boundary, and Cotter was so thrilled about this, he ran up and said, "I got him, Beth, I got him with my sucker ball." And I said, "For Cotto, all your balls are sucker balls." "Yeah, but I got him out, Baz. Now you've got to keep bowling me."
Moving to Melbourne with the band.
Yeah, yeah.
And, of course, then the idea of the pink was Wayne?
Yeah, that was Wayne DeGrinchy.
Idea?
Yeah, we owe him a lot because he was the one that came up with the concept and it really attracted attention.
I'm going to tell you a little story about the first time I really met Darryl. I bumped into him lots of times when I was on Young Talent Time and he'd be out at Channel 10 and all that kind of stuff. But this particular time, I was going over to Leslie Shaw's house, who was the producer of Young Talent Time. I was going over there to get a dog, Fred, a basset.
Fred, of course.
Yeah, because Leslie couldn't have him anymore. Yeah. And I said, "Yeah, I'll take Fred, you know." And when I walked in there, Darryl was sitting, and of course I knew it was him because he's so beautiful, and he was sitting on the floor in front of an open fire with some other guy who I can't remember who it was, but Robbie Porter was there, and Robbie Porter was a really big time producer then, and they had a stack of like singles, you know, 45s, and they'd listen to like three bars of it and then go, "Nah," and Robbie had just frisbeed them into the fire, you know, and I was like,
"Oh no."
It was like, really, for me, that was kind of bizarre behaviour. And I remember Darryl kind of looked at me like,
"Uh-oh."
So this, like, "I'm not doing this." Yeah. And I was like, "That's okay." He was always so sweet. Yeah. Such a sweet man and funny and a gentleman.
What's one word to describe him?
Kind.
Kind. Beautiful.
Mm, kind.
At one point during Zoot's career, Don Moody and I were asked to write a song for their next album, and we dutifully did so, and then we turned up at the Zoot House. I mean, that was back in the days.
Zoot House.
Yes, when bands all lived together in the same house. And we rocked up and there was this, I think it was Caulfield or something like this, this great house, and in the middle of it, in the living room, there they were all sitting and we were about to meet them and everything. And everywhere you looked, there were chicks. This is years before he ever married anyone, I've got to tell you. And there's fabulous chicks everywhere. And, you know, we're trying to do our thing and show them the song and there's just ladies everywhere. And afterwards, Moody and I are driving away and he said to me, "How come Axiom never get anything like that?"
Because I didn't have Darryl Cotton.
Is that a cut? Boy, not only that, not only that, they didn't have B. Birtles, they didn't have Rick Brewer, they didn't have, you know... We had me and Shorik. It's a different thing at all. We were more, let's say, we appealed to a different group.
Different group?
Yeah, National Geographic.
And how did you end up having your own television show? Because that went for a very long time. We're talking about Marty Monster.
Marty Monster, yeah. Which even today I have people, every week someone will stop me in the street and say, "How's Marty?" Or, you know, used to watch you as a kid.
Up with
you. I know, it was a fun show. I loved it. I loved doing it.
But it was a long time too, wasn't it?
Yeah, 5 years and 5 hours live every Saturday morning. So, but it was great. It was just something that...
How did you get that job?
Look, I don't know. Because when they rang me, I said, "You sure you got the right guy here? You know, I'm not the most outgoing person in the world." And I think they wanted another Shirley Strawn sort of, you know, because Shirley was always larger than life. So I did a telethon for Channel 10 and they included a little kids segment within the telethon for a couple of hours. And they rang me up and said, we'd like you to host this kids show. As I said, you sure? And anyway, we did it. And for a while I was pretty stiff, you know, and then one day it just, the penny dropped and just went like that. I thought, gosh, I was doing an interview with this group of school kids and we're just messing around. And I thought, at that point, I forgot there was a camera there, you know, and that was the secret of hosting a show.
Is
like
forgetting
that.
That you're on air.
Yeah.
But of course, it was, you've got the monster. And was it Marie?
Marie. Marie was the
gorgeous
co-host.
Marie.
Yeah, she was lovely. And that was, as you said, 5 years, and Marty was a great character.
Hey, Soozie here, and I'm here with David Triscott. Now, yeah. You might be saying,
Who's he?
Who's this bloke?
Who's he?
Will we tell him?
Yeah, you can tell him.
Cool. All right. This is Marty Monster. So tell us, you spent a lot of time with Darryl.
Yeah.
What about something about the man? What would you like to say about Darryl Cotton?
I know a lot of people say this, but he was the most generous man I've ever worked with. He was incredible. He just did everything for me and was always there for me. And he was just an amazing person that was so supportive. And he was like my manager, really, and created these gigs, which we did all over Australia, actually. So, we miss him very much.
Miss him. He is missed, but it feels like he's in the room tonight.
He does, absolutely.
What a fun night, isn't it? He'd
terrific.
Be laughing, wouldn't he?
Oh, yeah, he'd be having
imagine
a ball.
He'd be stoked.
Yeah.
They all are. Yeah.
Didn't have to lift a finger.
Nothing. Didn't even have to iron a shirt.
That's right, exactly.
So one word to describe Darryl.
Amazing.
Amazing.
Yeah, he's amazing.
He is amazing.
Good night, Daz.
Yeah. Thanks so much.
No worries.
Marty.
Right.
I work with him a lot, and actually when I first met him, I think it was on Marty Monster show.
Marty Monster, I love Marty
and,
Monster.
And he's naughty. Yes. He's naughty, but Darryl's just as naughty.
That was him.
And do you know what? The fantastic thing is most people kind of, you know, with Darryl, singer, musician, but you forget that he did all those skits and he dressed them up and he, you know, he gets in with it and he's very clever man.
Yeah.
He was a gentle man, and he had a wicked sense of humour.
Wrokdown.
So we're celebrating Darryl tonight. You
well, amongst
a ball?
Other things, yes. No, we are. We're celebrating Darryl and... although I suppose you would say, you know, on the face of it, it's not a very, you know, happy moment. It actually is, because he had such a great life and so many people loved him and he did so many great things. At the end of the day, I think you have to sum it up like that, don't you?
You do indeed.
I was in bed today, broken back, not allowed to get out of hospital, but I came.
Good on you. And the audience...
That's true. I feel my back. Whole
oh, you
back.
Have?
Yeah, I'm broken.
You're
it's
all
broken back.
Up.
I know.
You have.
I wasn't supposed to be out of bed.
But you had to be here.
No, I wasn't going to let this man down.
No.
He was... He also had a wicked sense of humour. We used to go away every year on what they call the variety bash.
Yeah.
So it'd be like 40 people going out into the outback and Darryl... It's hard to imagine, but when he dressed up, he could actually look a little bit like Steve Irwin. And
I'm trying to imagine that.
Well, I know. It sounds weird, but he did. And we all stopped and we were actually in the desert. And the 40 people stopped to have something to eat and drink. And we were just standing on this, you know, little riverbed. And all of a sudden there was this... from up in the tree and we looked up and there was Darryl dressed as Steve Irwin with a fake fake crocodile coming, oh, God. I mean he was just gorgeous, he was just lovely, and you know, we'll remember all those great things.
Yeah, great night, thank you, because we are celebrating the life of Darryl Cotton.
We
and
are.
What a great gentleman. Hey,
I've always been a jack of all trades, and,
yes,
you know, I've always done a bit of everything, and probably regret a little bit that I didn't work a little more on my music in terms of a musician, you know.
But the thing is, you can do that and still not have any more success.
There's
there's no guarantee that you could spend every waking hour of your life writing songs, there's no guarantee that you're going to have any success with it. I think you've been smart.
Oh, yeah, I would have liked to have perhaps been a better guitar player. I'd love to just, you know, I can sit around and play my guitar, but I'm not that good, you know. But at the same time, I have no regrets, you know. I've done so much. I did Neighbours. I acted in Neighbours. I was in The Young Doctors. I played
Le Jeune Docteur.
I was a broken down singer who had a caffeine addiction.
Oh, so, how dangerous.
Because I drank so much coffee. You know, that was the storyline.
Oh, how racy.
But I've done, and I love, and that was the same with Joseph. I love trying things.
Different things.
Yeah.
And I know for a fact, because we've been doing a few shows together,
yeah.
But this wonderful youth choir that you've been working with for how long?
Well, once again, I met them when I was doing the Early Bird show, and I became a patron of the choir. And
it is called the
Australian Youth Choir.
Australian Youth Choir.
And there's about 3,500 kids Australia-wide. And so I just help out wherever I can. And, in fact, we've done some concerts, which you helped me out with, and we do some recordings. And I just enjoy, working with the kids, but I just enjoy, once again, doing things different. I mean, in the concerts, I did some Bobby Darin songs, you know, which...
Beautiful.
I've never done that before, you know.
Well, in actual fact, I hadn't heard you sing Swing.
Yeah, and it was fun.
That's another...
No, so I'll probably continue to do that, you know. So there's, you know, and then, of course, Cotton Keys and Morris keeps plugging along. A little bit differently now that Jimmy... You had Jimmy on the show, didn't you?
And Russell.
Jimmy's been sick, but he's through the worst, and we're going to continue to work, but probably not as much.
Yeah, well, you've just got to...
Yeah,
He's got to watch himself.
Well, yeah, he's got to look after himself, and, you know, so who knows what the future will bring.
So tell me one word that it could describe Darryl.
He was very young.
Young.
I mean, he just kept being young. It was annoying.
He?
When he was 18, he was young. When he was 20, he was young. When he was 30, he was young. At 40, he was young. 50, he stayed young. Which is, I guess, part of the shock of the whole thing. The rest of us all looked like this, you know. And he took care of himself. He was terrific. Which I guess is a message in there that I should keep on doing all the bad things that I do.
And loving it.
And loving it!
Can't.